Well, since it's the long weekend, I want to follow up on the message from last Sunday, Mother's Day, before we get back into our series on about our Lord Jesus Christ and John's Gospel. And I want to develop a theme this morning that I touched on just for a few minutes last week, because I think it will be very helpful to you. The outline is in your program if you want to take it out and follow along. It's a topic that you don't hear an awful lot about in church these days. It's become a rather lost asset in our culture. It's what makes the difference between doing the right thing and the wrong thing. It's what makes the difference between being exposed to danger and avoiding danger. It's what makes the difference between finishing well and not finishing. It's what makes the difference between preserving your integrity and experiencing moral failure. It's what makes the difference between being a faithful follower of Christ and becoming an apostate. It's what enables you to make wise decisions and to not make bad decisions. I'm talking, of course, about your conscience. We use that word a fair bit in our culture. We talk about having a guilty conscience. The guilt is one of the functions of the conscience. In John chapter 8, verse 9, the story of the woman caught in adultery, for example, Jesus says to the crowd, "He who is without sin cast the first stone." And they which heard it, John records, being convicted by their own conscience, in other words, they're guilty, it says they went away one by one, beginning with the eldest. So the eldest had the heaviest sense of guilt because they've been around longer and their consciences have accumulated more guilt. You heard about the fellow that sent money to the income tax people with a note that says, "Here's some money that I owe you for back taxes because my conscience is bothering me. P.S. If my conscience continues to bother me, I'll send you the rest." So let's talk about the conscience, and that little outline in your bulletin will help you follow along. First of all, let's consider the purpose of your conscience. Your conscience is what God intended to produce a life of godly conduct. 2 Corinthians 1 verse 12 says, "For our proud confidence is this, the testimony of our conscience, that in holiness and godly sincerity, not in fleshly wisdom, but in the grace of God, we have conducted ourselves in the world and especially towards you." So it is his conscience that enables him to live a life of holiness and godly sincerity. 1 Timothy 1 verse 19 says the same thing, keeping faith and a good conscience. 2 Timothy 1 verse 3, this is the very end of Paul's life. It's the last letter Paul will write. In fact, Paul is going to be executed a very short time after he finishes writing 2 Timothy. He writes this, "I thank God whom I serve with a clear conscience." Imagine being able to say that right at the end of your life. "I've got a clear conscience." Now that is a godly man. That's a man who never sheds tears of regret at a funeral. Clear conscience. The purpose of your conscience is to keep you living a life of godly conduct. Your conscience is your navigational GPS, which steers you through the swamp of the cultural, moral minefield, and it'll keep you off the mines, and it'll ensure that you'll live a life of godly conduct. So that's the purpose of your conscience. Now let's talk about the value of your conscience, how important your conscience is. Your conscience is so important that the Bible says you must be very careful never, ever, ever to damage the conscience of another person. In the city of Corinth, they were selling discounted meat that had been offered to idols. Some Christians were taking advantage of this discounted fire sale price meat. And other Christians in the church thought that it was wrong to buy and to eat meat that had been offered to idols. And this was causing a problem in the church. For example, some Christians were being invited to the home of a non-believer. And these unbelievers were buying the meat that had been offered to idols and then serving it to their friends. And some Christians saw nothing wrong with this and were enjoying this meat. But other Christians were being invited to the same home. And so you've got two Christians sitting at the table of a non-believer. The unbeliever serves up meat that has been offered to idols. The one Christian is digging in and enjoying the meat. The other Christian, when the host goes out to the kitchen, says to the first guy, "Psst, this meat has been offered to idols." And this was creating a real dilemma for some Christians in the church, what to do. On the one hand, I've got an unbelieving host who is buying meat fire sale prices and serving it to us. I see nothing wrong with it, and I'm eating it, enjoying it. But I've got another Christian on my side here, and he's whispering to me that it is an offense to eat this meat, and it's an offense for the Christian brother to eat this meat. And so what is this Christian to do? So Paul answers the question for him in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Verse 27, listen to what Paul says. If one of the unbelievers invites you to dinner and you are disposed to go, in other words, if you want to go, eat whatever is set before you without raising any question on the ground of conscience. But if somebody says to you, that means if a believer or a fellow guest says to you, this has been offered in sacrifice, then do not eat it for the sake of the one who informed you and for the sake of conscience. I do not mean your conscience, but his. In other words, don't violate the conscience of another believer, because the conscience is a sacred thing. Now let's talk about the necessity of the conscience. Some people think you don't need conscience so long as you've got accountability. Accountability is a big word in our culture these days. In fact, accountability seems to have replaced conscience. You get into a group and you hold each other accountable. For example, let's say you want to become a more honest person. And so you gather a bunch of people around you and you ask each other to hold us all accountable, to be honest. So each time you meet, you ask each other the question, have you been honest this week? Have you told any lies this week? And here's the problem with accountability. You can lie about being honest. Like the actor who said the key to being a good actor is authenticity. If you can fake that, you've got it made. You see, if you really like the people that you're accountable to, you don't want to ever disappoint them. And so if you don't have a functioning conscience, you can lie about being honest. The greatest accountability in your life is not other people's accountability. It is the accountability of your own conscience. Accountability is a good thing, but conscience is better. Conscience is God's onboard built-in accountability in your life. Now, let's consider the function of your conscience. How does your conscience function? How does your conscience work? Your conscience functions like the sonar equipment on a ship. Sonar is like radar for the water. Remember the Costa Concordia a few years ago, January 13th, 2012? The Costa Concordia cruise ship with 4,000 passengers and crew left an Italian port as it made its way northwest up the coastline of Italy, Captain Francisco Chitino ordered the ship to sail by the little island of Giglio as a salute to a retired naval captain who lived on that little island. 2 hours after leaving port, the ship hit submerged rocks, and the impact tore a 160-foot gash in the port side of the boat, the size of an Olympic-sized swimming pool, flooding 3 of the ship's 7 watertight compartments. Unbelievably, the captain abandoned ship before the passengers did. He would later say that he tripped and by accident fell into a lifeboat. One of the late night comics said that the captain then got out of the lifeboat and tripped and fell into a taxi. The Concordia was shipwrecked. 32 people died. It's hard to imagine how a ship carrying state-of-the-art navigational and technological navigational and sonar equipment on a calm night, on calm seas, could ever become shipwrecked. GPS using space satellites tells a ship where it is on the ocean to within a couple of feet. Sonar equipment tells them how much depth they have between the bottom of the ship and the seabed. The moment the ship deviates from its prescribed course or is in any proximity to any danger, all kinds of alarms go off. So it begs the question, what happened? I read an article in Popular Mechanics on this and discovered there were 2 possibilities that happened that night. One expert said it is possible that the captain disabled the alarms. That would do it. Unplug the alarm system. Or second, nobody on the bridge was paying attention to the alarms. One expert said, ships are equipped with fathometers that let you know how much water is between the hull of the boat and the seabed. But if you ignore the alarm, it's not much use. Unplug the alarm or ignore the alarm. So your conscience is like sonar. Sonar equipment uses sound waves to gather data and information about the conditions around the ship, how deep the water is, how close the rocks are. And when the conditions become dangerous, the alarms go off. Well, that's exactly what the conscience does. It gathers information and it detects dangerous conditions and it triggers alarm bells, warning bells that alert you to the danger. But you can do what the captain did. You can ignore your conscience. And if you sin over and over and over and over again, the conscience at some point stops convicting. That's when you've unplugged your conscience. No longer works. And you ignore the alert at your peril. You end up on the rocks, shipwrecked. In fact, the Apostle Paul uses that exact analogy to do with the conscience in 1 Timothy 1:19. By rejecting a good conscience, Paul writes, some have shipwrecked their faith. The Bible describes an unplugged conscience as a seared conscience, S-E-A-R-E-D, a desensitized conscience, a conscience that doesn't work anymore. 1 Timothy 4:2 says, now the Spirit expressly says that in latter times some are going to depart from the faith by devoting themselves to deceitful spirits and teachings of demons through the insincerity of liars whose consciences are seared. They no longer work. Titus 1:15 says the same thing. To the pure, all things are pure, but to the defiled and to the unbelieving, nothing is pure, but their minds and their consciences are defiled. Conscience becomes unplugged. But something else has to happen before the conscience becomes unplugged. Sonar works by gathering data, information, reading distances. And the conscience works by gathering data, by accumulating information. We call it truth. The conscience is informed by the truth of Scripture. Before the conscience becomes unplugged, the conscience has to be first starved of truth. So the way to kill the conscience is by cutting off the truth supply lines. So you stop reading the Bible, you stop listening to sermons, you stop reading truth-based books and magazines, you stop listening to truth-based worship music such as we have been exposed to here this morning. That's what happens in a culture that abandons God. Before the conscience is unplugged, truth is first starved. First Romans 1 verse 18 says exactly that. By their unrighteousness, they suppress truth. They become futile in their thinking. Their foolish hearts are darkened. Proclaiming to be wise, they become fools because they exchange the truth about God for a lie. So when the conscience is starved of truth, that then leads to a lost conscience. That's what Romans 1:32 says. Though they knew God's righteous decree that those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but they give approval to those who practice them. So in other words, their conscience was informed. They knew what was right. But it's now been forgotten, it's now been overridden, and then conscience is lost. Starve the conscience of truth, and then you can override conscience. That's what Satan did to Eve in the Garden of Eden. First thing he did was to plant seeds of doubt about truth. He asked Eve, did God really say it? And then the second question was, God did not really say, because you will not die. So the first question sowed seeds of doubt. The second question was designed to flat out contradict and reject God's word. Once truth becomes doubted and then disbelieved, then conscience is lost. And the third step of disobedience for Adam and Eve becomes relatively easy. And then that leads to the next stage in Romans chapter 1. They invent ways to do evil. Unleashed evil. A culture that suppresses truth and then loses conscience will next experience unleashed evil. And you know that a culture is experiencing unleashed evil when its number one priority becomes safety and security. When everybody's worried about how safe we are, you know that a culture is at that point in Romans 1 where it is experiencing unleashed evil. All because truth has been suppressed, which leads to a lost conscience. Now, let's see the strength then of the conscience. The strength of the conscience lies in its exposure to truth. A highly functioning conscience is a truth-informed conscience. Sonar is informed by truth. It sends out a sound wave through the water, and that measures the distance between the bottom of the boat and the bottom of the ocean. If sonar gets false information, it becomes unreliable. If your conscience gets wrong information or believes on truths, then your conscience becomes unreliable. 1 Corinthians 8, verses 6 and 7, the Apostle Paul writes, "There is one God, the Father, from whom are all things, and for whom we exist, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom are all things, and through whom we exist." Verse 7, "However, not everybody possesses this knowledge, but some, through former association with idols, are eating food as really offered to an idol, and their conscience, being weak or uninformed, is defiled." So a weak conscience believes stuff that is not true. And so if the conscience is not rightly informed, two things happen. Number one, you misunderstand true holiness. You think holiness is about something that really has nothing to do with true holiness. And second, you judge and become critical of other people who don't share the same perspective. That's what's happening in the Corinthian church. So the conscience must be rightly informed. Well, that begs the question, by what? Well, obviously by Scripture. 2 Corinthians 4 verse 2 says, "We have renounced disgraceful, underhanded ways. We refuse to practice cunning or to tamper with God's word. But by the open statement of the truth, we commend ourselves to everybody's conscience in the sight of God." A strong conscience is fed by Scripture. 2 Corinthians 5:11 says, "Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others. But what we are is known to God, and I hope it is known also to your conscience." A strong conscience is a well-fed conscience. A well-fed conscience is a conscience that is fed by the pure, unadulterated truth of Scripture. There's a wonderful illustration of this in Psalm 19. Listen to all of the descriptions and the benefits of Scripture according to Psalm 19. For example, "The law of the Lord is perfect, and it revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether." All those beautiful descriptions of the Scripture and what the Scripture does in a person's life. Then listen to how much the psalmist loves the Scripture. "More to be desired are they than gold, than much fine gold, sweeter than honey and the drippings of the honeycomb." Now, watch the two aspects of Scripture. Verse 11, "There, moreover, by them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward." Two aspects of Scripture: to give warning and to be obeyed. Warning and obeying. Those are the two aspects of a sonar system on a ship. It sends out a warning signal, and the warning signal needs to be heeded. Warning and keeping. Now, what does the Scripture warn you about? Well, sin, to put it bluntly. What kind of sin? Well, in the next verse, he spells out four types of sin that the Scripture warns you about. An informed conscience will identify four categories of sin. Look at them right in Psalm 19. The first is what the psalmist calls unknown sin. That's in verse 12. "Who can discern his errors?" In other words, who knows the depths of error in his own heart? In other words, sometimes there is sin in our life that is so deep that we're not even aware of, because we're imperfect people. And sometimes we make mistakes. Sometimes we say and do the wrong thing, not intentionally, but we just get it wrong sometimes. And when we get it wrong, we're not even aware that we've got it wrong. Sometimes we hurt people, and we're not even aware that we've hurt people. That's why God says, be still and know that I am God, so that I can reveal to you stuff in your heart that you need to pay attention to. That's why David prays in Psalm 139, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there is any grievous way in me. I'm always wary of anybody who claims that they never get it wrong, they never make a mistake, because Scripture says otherwise. There is always going to be unknown sin in our hearts. An informed conscience will illuminate unknown sin. It will alert you to things that you're doing that are hurting you or hurting other people in your life. That is a fully informed conscience at work. The second type of sin, category of sin that a fully informed conscience will get at is hidden sin. Look what Psalm 19 says. Declare me innocent from hidden faults. So, besides unknown sins, there are hidden sins. Those are sins that you are aware of, but nobody else is. That's why they're hidden. And if your conscience is not setting off an alarm, it's because you're ignoring it, or you've seared it, you've unplugged it. Then there's a third category of sin mentioned here in verse 13, and that is presumptuous sin. Verse 13 says, keep back your servant also from presumptuous sins. Presumptuous sins are those sins that we get presumptuous about, and we presume that God winks at them. In other words, they're sins that we know are sins, but God doesn't take them seriously. They're what we might call socially acceptable sins. There's two types of sins, two lists of sins in church. There are the socially reprehensible types of sins that preachers love to list. They're everybody's favorite target. They're the sins of the culture. They are sins that this wicked world indulges in, but the preacher never, ever, ever would commit any of these sins. At least that's the way they're portrayed. So there is the socially reprehensible list of sins. And then on the other hand in church, there is the socially acceptable sins. The problem with those lists is that Scripture makes no such distinction between the two. In fact, James says, if you break one of God's laws, you've broken all of them. Romans chapter 3 says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And the verse before that says, there is no difference among anybody. In other words, we all stand guilty before a holy God. A fully informed conscience will give no quarter for presumptuous sins. It will take all sin seriously, and it will not allow for the growth of what we call socially acceptable sins, such as gossip and talking behind people's backs. All the socially acceptable sins that we're all good with, we will take all sin very, very seriously. And then the fourth type of sin is parasitic sins. These are sins that get a grip off you. They get their teeth into you, and they won't let go. They are addictive type sins. Look what David says in verse 13 of Psalm 19. Let them not have dominion over me. These are the addictive, parasitic sins that get their teeth into you and they won't let go. They're like the snake wrapping itself around the little snake charmer who blows on his little flute, and the snake comes out of the basket and wraps itself around the little snake charmer and puts his head on the top of the head of the little snake charmer. He's done it every day, every week, every month, every year for many, many years, until one day the little snake comes out, or the big snake comes out of the basket, curls itself around him, puts his head on the top of the head of the little snake charmer, and then when the little snake charmer changes the tune to get the snake to unravel himself, this one day he doesn't do it. And instead of unraveling, the snake squeezes tighter and squeezes the breath out of the little snake charmer. That's what parasitic sin does. Everybody says, I can handle it, I can handle it, I can handle it, until the day they can't. First step in getting free from parasitic sin is to admit its power over you. That's a fully informed conscience. And an informed conscience will convict you of all of these sins. And then look at the reward for a fully informed conscience. Still in Psalm 19, then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression. What a great reward. To be able to get to the end of my life and say, I've got a clear conscience. I'm not shedding one tear of regret for anything. I'll never, ever go to a funeral and shed a tear of regret and say, I wish I had done things differently with this person. That's the mark of a clear conscience. And then finally, look at the focus of a fully informed conscience. Look at verse 14. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. There is the key to a clear conscience. This is why you want to live, to have a clear conscience, because He is in your sight. He is the focus of your attention. Your eyes and your mouth and your meditation of your heart just wants to be acceptable to Him. You want to please Him. Why? Well, Hebrews 9:14. How much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered Himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God? How's that for a reason to want to live a life with a clear conscience? Because He died for me. He shed His blood for me, and His shed blood cleanses my conscience of all unrighteousness. Why would I not want to live the rest of my life to say thank you to Him? A healthy conscience is captivated by the Lord Jesus Christ. It's cleansed and it's forgiven, and it just longs and lives to be acceptable to Him, to want to please Him. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for our morning together. We thank You that You have given us this gift of a conscience and the gift of truth to inform it. Lord, help us to know the truth, to love the truth, to have a passion for the truth, a desire for the truth, to search the truth and keep that conscience clear by Your Holy Spirit, through confession, repentance, to wash it so that it's always revealing to us the full light of the truth, that we might do that which is pleasing to You and live to Your eternal glory. Father, if there is anyone here this morning who does not have a clear conscience, I pray, Father, that if they do not know the Lord Jesus Christ, they would reach out to Him right now. That they would believe in the living Christ, the one who shed His blood to cleanse our conscience. I pray, Father, that that dear one, whatever mistake they have made, whatever failure is in their life, that they would call out to You and ask for Your forgiveness. I pray, Father, that if they do not know Christ, that they may make the decision this day to believe in Christ, to trust Christ, and to live for Christ from this day forth for the rest of their life. Father, for the rest of us, I pray that we would live with the wonder of a clear conscience and loving Your word. In Christ's wonderful name we pray. Amen.